course, someone who needs no introduction, Inger Anderson, the Executive Director of United Nations Environment Program. We also have the honor of Ms. Steffi Lemke, who is the Minister of Environment in Germany. And then we also have the pleasure of course, Elizabeth Marema, who is the Secretary General of the Executive Secretary of the Secretariat for Convention on Biological Diversity. Each of them will make a short statement, and then we will open it up for comments. Please, for the press, when you ask a question, please indicate your name and which outlet you are with. Thank you. Inger, please.
Thank you, and members of the press, members of media, it's a great pleasure to be with you here today. As we will shortly hear from Her Excellency Minister Steffi Lemke, this is a significant announcement that she will make. But let me just say that health impacts of climate change, nature and biodiversity loss and pollution and waste, they're all around us. But they're not just around us, they are in us. And we have understood that as zoonotic diseases became a word that more people knew than we wanted them to know, because all of a sudden COVID-19 arrived on the global agenda. Now, we have had zoonoses many times before, Marburg, Zika, HIV/AIDS, Ebola, I could go on, but they have been more localized and not in full pandemic form. Each of these have an emergence in the animal kingdom. And we understand that the changing climate that we are living with is creating the conditions for deadly diseases to inhabit new breeding grounds, a trend that's already growing at 1.1 degrees of Celsius of global warming, that such as what was told to us by the IPCC just on Monday. And meanwhile, pollution, not zoonosis, obviously, pollution is serving up an unpalatable and unwanted buffet of health risks, from toxic chemicals to dirty air, to antimicrobial resistance. So the threats and their causes are complex and interlinked, but the bottom line is, when the planet gets sick, people get sick too. And if we are to act on the triple planetary crisis, well, then we must protect human health, but we also must protect the planetary health as well as veterinary health. So the One Health approach that treats human health, animal health, and here I'm talking about domesticated animal health, and the broader planetary health, where obviously wild animal health is one dimension. These three dimension, human, veterinary, as well as planetary health, are one and the same dimension of the One Health process. And One Health needs to be coordinated so that we can assess, respond, and prevent problems that might occur in the future. And that means working not in separate pillars with the human health, our hospitals, et cetera, and public health, our veterinarians, and our environmental experts. Now, clearly, they have different domains and different responsibilities, but we need to understand that interlinkage. And much work has been done in the past on obviously human health and veterinary health, but less understanding has been made and clear on the dimension of planetary health and what are the aspects that we can do rather than chasing the diseases as they emerge into animals and humans. How can we ensure that what is in nature stays in nature and have a clearer understanding of that? And that will involve working with more sustainable farming practices, with setting up early warning systems, with promoting sustainable trade in domestic and wild species, and in strengthening the tenure and management rights of local communities and indigenous people. So it is an underfunded dimension. We have funded human health well, and that is necessary. We have funded veterinary health better, but we have underfunded the planetary dimension. So we are behind on the One Health dimension when it comes to planetary health. But we can reduce the risks of pandemics. We can save millions of lives and, frankly, billions of dollars in healthcare costs, and we can slow down the triple planetary crisis. So if that isn't a return on investment, then I don't know what is. With that, let me stop and hand it over to the minister. Thank you.
Minister.
Thank you, Inga. Excellencies, colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, as we meet here today, the COVID-19 pandemic is still having terrible impacts all around the world on people and livelihoods, on health systems and economies, and on nature too. The scientific evidence presented to us, for example, through IPBES, is clear. Our health ultimately depends on the health of our planet. Without preventive strategies, pandemics will become even more frequent and are likely to have increasingly disastrous impacts. Thanks to UNEP, CBD, IPBES, and many other partners, the environmental dimensions of health have finally been brought to light in recent months. The One Health approach clearly demonstrates that environmental protection is key to successfully preventing future pandemics. This is why Germany has joined forces with our partners and set up the new multi-partner trust fund, Biodiversity for Health and Pandemic Prevention. I am delighted to announce today that through our International Climate Initiative, Germany is able to provide 50 million euros to kickstart the initiative. I'm convinced that this initiative will make a huge contribution to recognizing biodiversity and climate change as key factors in determining human and animal health and well-being. It will create multidisciplinary evidence as a basis for decision-making. It will create awareness and build up the required capacities, and above at all, it will focus on implementation of preventive One Health action and policies at local, national, and regional level. The initiative will provide necessary policy support, for instance, by supporting One Health platform and strengthening biodiversity and climate change, concerns in public health, and other relevant sector policies. It will also contribute to implement the One Health approach in critical landscapes. A team of experts is currently developing the operational details of this initiative as part of an inception phase. I am very much looking forward to its results. The scale of our task over the coming years is huge. That is why this is a multi-partner initiative. I would like to thank UNEP Executive Director Inga Andersen and the CBD Executive Secretary Elisabeth Meremra and the incredible teams of highly motivated and dedicated experts behind this initiative from UNEP, the CBT Secretariat, WHO, OIEI, UNDP, IUCN, EcoHealth Alliance, as well as the UN's Multi-Partner Trust Fund Office. Without our excellent work, this would not have been possible. In addition, I would like to invite our other partners and countries across the world to join this initiative. We need further contributions to this multi-partner trust fund in order to extend its reach and it tap its full potential. Together, we can make a significant contribution to fulfilling our commitments under the Paris Agreement and advancing the work on a post-2020 global biodiversity framework. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Elizabeth.
Thank you very much, Inga, dear Madam Minister, for the not just the words, but more so the commitment we are seeing. The fact that we are here this last one or for many others probably 2 weeks, is a clear recognition that the world or all of us are at a critical juncture in the history of humankind. For biodiversity, scientists have clearly told us that biodiversity is declining at an unprecedented rate in the history of humankind, putting the risks of our own livelihoods, our own health, and of our own well-being. So clearly then, we need to urgently restore our relationship with nature. This is why we have the post-2020 Global Biodiversity Framework negotiations going on at this moment. In the last few weeks, we'll also, and the outcomes, the decisions which have been taken already, will tremendously contribute towards these positive negotiations on the framework. The post-2020 framework is an important development. It is not only that it will provide our roadmap to put biodiversity on a path to recovery by 2030, but it will also be a prescription to ensure that our health, our well-being, and for all being restored and being able to restore that healthy planet. To address, therefore, the issue of biodiversity and health linkages, including the pandemic risks, a global action plan for biodiversity and health is currently being discussed as part of the framework negotiations. The uptake of this action plan will be greatly facilitated by the multi-partner trust fund, which Madam Minister has just announced. It will serve three purposes. One, as an accelerator for strengthening environmental dimension of One Health. It will catalyze the uptake of biodiversity inclusive One Health approach at all levels. But it will also be a driver for linking healthy policies and implementation measures. So this is precisely the type of partnership and initiatives that will be essential to drive the post-2020 global biodiversity framework that will address health and the triple planetary crises. The trust fund will have not been possible without, Minister, your leadership, the leadership of the government of Germany, Inga, equally your leadership, but also without our founding sister organizations, all of which will bring this unique expertise to this partnership being announced today. We thank you, the leaders. We thank all the partner organizations for their commitment, and we hope that more countries and more partners will join this initiative. We look forward to work hand in hand with all of you, all the partners, organizations, and the countries to really restore our broken relationship with nature and advance the One Health and well-being. Thank you.
Thank you. So now we have a chance for the press to ask any questions. First, I'll ask, is there anyone in the room who has any questions? Otherwise, I will take an online question. And the first question is for the minister. Minister, the question is, why is biodiversity and health so important for Germany?
I would answer in German. It's a little bit more easier for me. Biodiversität ist für uns alle so wichtig, weil unsere natürlichen Lebensgrundlagen damit verbunden sind, die Nahrungsmittelproduktion, aber auch die Frage, ob wir ein stabiles Ökosystem haben, das uns vor Stürmen, vor Hochwasser, vor Dürreereignissen schützt. Ein stabiles Ökosystem, das von Biodiversität lebt. Biodiversität ist die Grundlage dafür, ist notwendig für all das, was wir jeden Tag tun.
Biodiversity is highly important for us because it is our natural basis for life. It is linked with everything, for example, with our food production. It is also linked to the question whether we have stable ecosystems that protect us from storms, floods, or droughts. Stable ecosystems are based on a healthy biodiversity, and such a healthy biodiversity is the basis of our daily lives.
Thank you. The next question we have is for Inger. Inger, what can we do for nature to reduce health risks?
So we need to understand that around 76% of all zoonotic diseases, all new infectious diseases that have arrived amongst the human population in the last many years are in fact zoonoses in basis. So they are zoonotic diseases in origin. Then they can mutate, and today we live with the flu or whatever we live with, and we believe that it's just a regular human disease, but its origin have zoonoses and bases. So understanding that then is one point. And that means then that the kind of dimension that Minister mentioned, a stable, steady biodiversity that is not a biome that is remain intact and in balance, is a much better and not so much of a vector of diseases that first go into wild animals and then into some carrier species, a bat, a rat, what have you, and then possibly to the human population, maybe via a domesticated animal. Understanding that the way we live with the wild, quote unquote, the way we encroach on wild spaces or not, is a dimension to which we can either, we will either see zoonotic diseases emerge more likely or not. There was a study maybe 10 years ago, cannot recall exactly, on the Zika virus, and it indicated that where the biodiversity was under stress, this is where the Zika could blossom more, not blossom, but you understand, could emerge more powerfully. Why? Because that normal balance that ecosystems are in was disturbed. Now, I cannot say that that is a generic point. Nevertheless, it teaches us something about the imbalance that human interference in wild ecosystems can cause. And of course, when we then, on top of that, illegally trade wildlife, and when we then sit species that belong on different continents, but we sit them in cages on top of each other, we are, in fact, creating a petri dish for new diseases. So all of that are dimensions that we hope to be looking at with many partners in this context. And just a shout out to my colleague, Elizabeth Marema, who is Executive Secretary of the CBD, because as she stressed, the Convention for Biological Diversity will seek to land some fairly ambitious goals in this regard in the COP coming up that she heads up. Thank you.
And we received one last question for Elizabeth. How important is this issue to achieving the objectives of the Global Biodiversity Framework?
Thank you very much for the question. I think we all need to recognize the forward-looking manner, the way the parties to the Convention on Biological Diversity had been. You may not believe it. At our last COP, which was 2018, this was before the pandemic, the parties had taken a decision whereby they had asked the Secretariat to specifically lead the process for the development of the global plan of action on biodiversity and healthy linkages. Nobody thought we would be in the situation today, and yet the parties had already asked for that. So this process has been going on together or in tandem with the development of the post-2020 Global Biodiversity Framework. The action plan will be discussed at our next subsidiary body on science, which will be meeting next month in Geneva. And again, during the same month, further development of the framework will continue. We have countries or parties and some stakeholders are already calling for a specific target on one health approach, Currently, one of the targets, specifically target 11, takes cognizance of access to and benefit from green and blue species for human health and well-being in urban areas as well as other densely populated. But then this is still a subject of discussion, whether it will be One Health as a target or not, because others say One Health is a cross-cutting issue, and if one has an opportunity to read the Global Action Plan on Biodiversity and Healthy Linkages, we will see the focus is on cross-cutting, cross-sectorial dimension of mainstreaming biodiversity and health on all sectors of the economy under one whole of government, whole of economic sectors, also social approach. So the linkages are there, very critical. Not surprising, they are all being developed at this same time, and we hope this action plan will be adopted at the next conference of the parties later this year, together with the framework when it will be also discussed and hopefully adopted. Thank you.
Thank you to this wonderful panel for this exciting news. We are encouraging.
One thing before you close it
out. Oh, absolutely.
Just to mention, since we are at the end, tail end of UNEP 5, it is important to stress that this assembly, UNEP 5, adopted a resolution that deals with biodiversity and health. And that is significant. It was not easy, and there was complex negotiations around it, but we at UNEP are absolutely delighted to see that. We have long had a close collaboration, as Minister mentioned, with WHO, OIE, and our friends at FAO, but having that resolution here actually matters and creates a very nice bridge to Kunming, as well as to the imperatives that this generous German contribution of 50 million euros will make possible. I just wanted to add that.
Thank you, Inger. So UNEP Indeed. Welcomes additional partners to reach out. With that, thank you for the event, and have a wonderful day.
Thank you.